And now we're back with David Hoffman from Peoria talking about trumpet and music. All right, Dave, question for you. If when you're learning like a really new complex piece, what do you have to do to approach that?
Is there
certain things that you do, or
yeah,
you know, repeat the bar over and over and do the metronome thing, or
I start without a metronome, playing something really slow and not doing too much at a time. Just a bar or whatever it is. And usually in a passage you can locate what the real problem parts are, and it's usually not all of it. Usually if something challenges you every note, you know, it's probably not the thing to learn. But if you have to, then you have to do it, you know, just a few notes at a time, very slowly. And then as I get it, then I'll put the metronome on it really slow. But make sure to do not very much at a time, and really slowly, and build it up so that the foundation is there, so you're not just sloughing through it.
Nice. And do you have to revisit it, or is it something that you pretty much then have under your fingers?
I have to revisit something all the time. There are some things that if I know I'm going to need to play them, I say, okay, I need to practice this. And it'll come back quicker because you've already learned it. But I think with me, it's always a process of having to relearn things.
Do you have certain licks that you practice? I got this thing in E-flat that I practice a lot, and I know that when I see an E-flat change, I know I can whip this one out, or...
I like to work on, if I'm practicing a lick or something, I like to do it in all keys.
Really?
Yeah.
C-sharp?
Yeah, oh yeah. Oh yeah. Well, because if you're playing a tune like the example everyone uses is Cherokee. If it starts out in an easy key on the A section, you know, the first chord of the bridge is up a half a step. So no matter where you're stepping and where you're starting, you're going to have some part of that tune that hits keys that you don't play very often. And a lot of times I'll practice a tune in all keys. At least I'll practice a tune in a few different keys. But if I only do it in a few different keys, I'll do it in the keys that don't feel as comfortable to me. But I like to, I have this app called iReal Pro, and you can put changes in there, and then you can have it go up a half step every chorus. And I'll set it on 24 choruses, not play all of them because your chops will be dead, but, you know, have it go up a half step all the way through, and then it does it again. And you learn very quickly which keys you're weak in, and sometimes it's not what you think it's going to be.
Huh, I hadn't thought of that. Using iReal Pro that way. That's really interesting.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite things to do with iReal.
You mentioned technology and recording in the basement. How have editing tools and recording influenced your trumpet playing? Did you change anything about your, say, hey, I'm going to go back and insert this great lick here and edit it? Or I'm just going to do it through composed, and whatever I get is what I get.
I pretty much go through it like I'm improvising it, so that I don't like go in and, for instance, punch in a couple notes usually or something. I like early takes, and I found out over the years that the earlier takes are always the best ones. And if I'm not getting it at that point, I don't think it's what I need, then I'll come back to it the next day.
And you know, speaking of one takes, mm-hmm. the early takes, I was at a session with Frank Mantooth mm-hmm. and Bobby Shue.
Yeah.
And they were downtown in Chicago and recording, and I was one of Frank's students, and he invited me into the session. Mm. And it was really nice, and got to meet Bobby. And,
yeah.
But Bobby, when he was playing, he would always say, you know, he would have a little clinker, but that's Bobby, and
yeah.
that's his style, and he would always have a little clinker in there. And you know, Frank said, "Well, I'm okay with it. Are you?" And goes, "Yeah, that's me, man."
Yeah, I think when things get too you get too particular with stuff like that, then it starts not sounding like music anymore. I don't do much of that. My first MIDI setup was some synths, some early, you know, hardware synths, into just a sequencer. And I would have one chance to, and as I had all of that playing, I had all of that out, and the sequence was playing, I would just add a horn part on top of it. So there was no punching in. There was like you had to go beginning to the end. And there was no balancing it later because you're going straight to a stereo track. And I really enjoyed that. So I kind of stayed to not wanting to spend too much time on making something technically perfect.
I wrote a warm-up book on how to play the trumpet and such, but do you have any specific exercises that you swear by before performing, going to a performance or practice, any specific warm-ups? You know, I do pedal tones, and I go up to my highest notes so that I can hit, and the mm-hmm. lowest notes, and, you know, tonguing, flexibility, and the whole yeah. routine. Do you have any specific, but I try not to overplay, you know, because
right.
of course you can overplay and then mess up your chops for the gig.
Yeah, I like to warm up. If I have a gig in the evening, I like to warm up sometime in the afternoon if I can. So that I have a few hours between, and I try to do a nice routine, like a 45-minute routine.
Oh,
and I'll start sometimes with just a few long tones, starting out with no tongue, just foo, and just to make sure the vibration is there, and then I'll either do long tones up and down, or I'll do a Claude Gordon routine that goes down to the pedal tones and then goes up. And then I like to do like the Clark number 2, but start it out. Like really slow. And go through it once slow and then speed it up so mm-hmm. so that you really kind of get everything flowing, and then go through that in all keys.
I heard a funny story of Arnold Jacobs.
Yeah.
And I never got to take a lesson with him. I regret that a lot.
Oh, yeah.
But he would, you call him on Sunday, pay $80, and then have a lesson with him on Monday. And he would say, "Well, play me something." And inevitably, apparently, the trumpet player would start doing some Clark.
Yeah.
And he would just flip his lid. Oh, you trumpet players and Clark.
Yeah.
You're doing that all the time.
Yeah.
And I just thought that was very funny.
We do it all the time because it's effective, you know. And that's probably a lot of times I'll mess with him. I'll say, okay, let me do this in, Lydian mode, or I'll do the hardest thing is doing chromatic, everything being chromatic. But I saw Alan Vizzuti doing that once. I thought, oh, this is an interesting way to change up the Clark stuff. And there's a bunch of stuff you could do.
Yeah, Vizzuti has quite a few technical books out there.
Oh, yeah.
With the extended Clark.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's, and then I'll usually just, sometimes just playing a nice ballad or two to get sound going, and as an extended long tone thing, it's like instead of just doing a G for 20 seconds, doing a chorus of a beautiful ballad can kind of be more entertaining.
I know this sounds funny, but I went through a little stretch in college where trumpet playing became not fun for me.
Uh-huh.
It was like it was work. It wasn't fun anymore. I wasn't enjoying it. And it was just a difficult time. And I'm comparing myself to all the other players at the school and all the other things. Yeah. And it was very difficult. How do you stay inspired and motivated throughout a career of playing the trumpet?
I think...
Did you ever go through a spell where you were like, I'm not doing it today?
I don't think I've ever gone through a time where I was really discouraged with music. Now, there were times where there are days when, you pick up the trumpet and you want to just put it right down because it's not doing what you want. And there's some days, especially when I didn't have to play, where I would say, okay, I'm going to put this down and go do something else. I don't think there's ever been an extended period of being really... Well, there has lately. There's been some extended periods of just having real chop problems from... I didn't play when I had this spinal thing going on. Then I finally got COVID after years of not getting it. And that seemed to mess up trumpet playing for quite a while. But I think something you said that's probably leads to the most dissatisfaction is if you start comparing yourself to someone else. You know, this man, I wish I could do this as well as this guy. And
we had some real screamers in college.
Yeah.
And I kept trying and trying. And I have a good high range.
Mm-hmm.
I use what people call the Calais Super Chops method.
Yeah.
Where your top lip comes down, mm-hmm, and you bite.
Right.
And you get this, that's how you're getting the compression.
Right.
But I this one guy, and I'll say Greg Helton's name, could just blast.
Yeah.
And he could blow out the entire band and lead the entire band and just was a player with chops. Just chops that didn't, mm-hmm, didn't end. And I'm like, damn, that is something else. I'm very impressed with his playing. And the chops that he had, and the strength. Yeah.
Yeah, I've played with a bunch of people that that kind of never miss.
And that's okay, we got three dogs here, so they're going to be on the recording too. You can see me.
Good.
You mentioned some misconceptions that people have. What do you think are some misconceptions about the trumpet that you've encountered? Did you need to have as much air or other things like that?
Yeah.
It's an easy instrument?
Well, of course, when people first starting playing trumpet, they look at oh, it has three of those buttons on it. It must be easier than playing a saxophone, right? You know, so I think that's, people look at a trumpet and see how simple it is and think it's easy to play. In fact, I used to do clinics for little kids, and you know, I'd have a horn and I'd say, how do you play this? Of course, some kid goes, you blow into it. Right? So, oh, nothing happens. It must not be just blow. You wiggle the valve, those buttons. You know, it doesn't happen again. So, you know, finally someone says, you spit into it, right? And just the misconception of you can just blow into this thing and get a sound is, I think, the largest misconception people have. And as far as trumpet players, I do think all of us tend to think it's more strenuous than it is. And it is strenuous. I mean, there's times, you know, you get tired, and there's times where you're you have a piece of brass like sitting on this little bitty muscle here, you know, so it's going to get worn out, and you're going to have to build up, you know, a lot of stuff. So I think the misconception is that you can muscle your way through it, and you can do it for a while, and then it gets to the point where everything stops, and then you have to go back and say, well, maybe if I approach this with a little more subtlety, it would be easier to play in the long run.
Yeah. Do you think it takes more or less air to play the trumpet?
More or less air than what?
You know, than what we're being taught. You know, there's all kinds of breathing exercises out there, breathing aids, volume, inspirometers, and all kinds of things to improve your airflow and your breathing. Is this all garbage, or is this needed for trumpet playing?
I think anything that really helps the way you breathe is probably going to be helpful in the long run. What I do with students is say, well, take your mouthpiece out. Take a look at the size of that hole that you're putting air through. There's no way you're going to get through that hole, you know? And then what's going to happen is, you know, you're just going to, it's going to be like blowing up a balloon. You know, it's just not going to work. So getting the right flow, and also, you know, I think what does help is learning to think of the lower part of the lungs first, you know, just that used to call stomach breathing, which has nothing to do with the stomach, of course, but it's just thinking about bringing that air in very low.
You were on the road for so many years with Ray, and in your own career, could you share a few of Road Warrior's stories with us? Something that kind of stood out, or some funny anecdote, or anything that happened over the years?
Oh boy,
there's got to be tons. This is the fun stuff now. There's got to be tons.
Let me think of
any jokes, practical jokes. Any? You talked about books and how you shared and different
things. Oh, you know, when I was on the road, it was before everyone had phones that had everything in them. It was so you had to carry physical books. And what would happen is you had one big book club because you couldn't carry that many books in your suitcase. So you'd have one, and a book could be passed around, and all of a sudden you had something to talk about other than the gig. Same way with music. Everyone had headphone splitters, and you'd listen to each other's music all the time. So those were kind of the nowadays, you know, you can do everything with your phone. But it was, probably wasn't before 1994 or 95 when you had started having cell phones at all. You know, before then, you're pretty out of touch. And in a way, it was cool to be out of touch because you only had one thing to worry about, and that was getting to the gig. I like this story. It's about getting to the gig, and if you decide to get off the bus and get your own way to the gig, which sometimes people did, say they wanted to visit someone along the way, you know, or go home or something and meet at the gig. Of course, you had the challenges of getting there. So we're playing this gig out on the East Coast somewhere, and one of our trumpet players and one of our trombone players are not at the gig yet, and it's 5 minutes before the gig starts. And I guess what happened, they'd run out of gas in the Chesapeake Tunnel, which was really fun. So Ray would call three to five instrumentals before he came on stage. And
okay, the walker has gone by.
Okay.
Now continuing on with the story of the horn players stuck in the Chesapeake Tunnel.
And it was just, you know, big book of tunes, 500 tunes in it. And this night, and we get this list right before we go on stage, Ray calls one of the few tunes that this particular trumpet player improvises on. And so we thought, and he happened to be my roommate, and I thought, I know his playing well. I'll just play a solo and Ray will never know. So I play a solo. Everyone says, yeah, it sounded a lot like Kurt. Kurt showed up, you know, a couple tunes later, and everything's cool. And when after the gig, when Ray was going back behind the stage, I heard him say, "And Hoffy, I knew that was you." So I didn't fool him for a minute.
No, I imagine he had a really good ear. Yeah,
he had a good ear. And sometimes getting there was the hardest thing. We were starting out at sea level one time, and the gig was near Albertville, where they had the Olympics in France, you know, a few years ago.
Were you always mic'd up in the smaller venues or the bigger venues? And
we were never mic'd up.
Did your trumpet playing have to change for the acoustics of a room?
Yeah, you were always playing the acoustics of the room. There
never
were just
mic'd up.
Pardon?
Never mic'd up?
Nope, there were two overall mics in front. That's it. And in small venues, there wasn't that. It was totally acoustic. There were some old vaudeville theaters that had been fixed up on the East Coast that, you know, like 1,000, 1,200-seat theater, maybe less, that we didn't use any sound reinforcement at all except for Ray's vocals and the Raylettes and then Ray's a keyboard. And it was one time where a local promoter came into our dressing room and said, "I'd like to know who was doing your sound because I'd like to hire him for other gigs because everything was perfect." And we said, There was no one doing the sound. There was no sound. It was the acoustics of the room. And of course, big outside places, of course, those two overall mics had to handle it all. But
do you know what kind of mics they were?
It depended on the venue.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't carry any sound reinforcement stuff.
Ray didn't have...
No, that was all at all the venue.
Wow.
All we carried was, you know, bass amp, guitar amp, amp for Ray's keyboard. That's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
What would you say was the most rewarding aspect of being a lifelong trumpet player?
Being able to share the music, being able to play, work at it, and then go and share it with other people. I mean, that's the nature of music, is you want to share it. And I think that is the most fulfilling aspect of it.
What do you hope to accomplish next in your trumpet playing journey?
I don't know. I guess I have not known for 60 years, so that's not a big revelation. But I've always just tried to go with the flow. You know, whatever happens next, that seems cool.
Can you talk more about your six albums that you did and you recorded? Three were kind of meditation, new age-ish, kind of more stuff in it, more melodic content.
Right.
And what were the other three?
I did a couple just straight-ahead jazz records.
Oh, now, is this a combo?
It was a combo, yeah.
Okay. Was this recorded in a studio or at home?
It was the jazz ones were recorded in the studio. Used a couple studios up in Chicago. There was sometimes I was in Southern California and used a studio out there. Because there's just, you know, there's just more to do. When I was recording stuff myself, you know, I was just kind of adding tracks one at a time. And a straight ahead jazz thing, you just want everyone playing at once. And so two of them were just straight ahead jazz. One was, I did it myself with a couple people coming in, which is more...
did you write the pieces?
I wrote almost everything on... did I have any standards on...
Right in the middle there of talking about if you had standards in your albums.
Not very many.
You didn't have to pay the Fox.
You don't have to. You don't have to pay other people like that. And I do what jazz musicians have done since the beginning is sometimes I'll use a chord progression you like playing on and write a contrafact to it.
How did you distribute them? Did you distribute them? I mean, everything now is digital, and you can go through like CD Baby or some other distributor and put your stuff online for $10 a song.
Right.
But how many CDs did you make, and would you sell them at the gigs, or did you find a distributor? Did you go with a label? How about the music business side of things there?
Well, I never managed to get, you know, a long-term distribution agreement with anyone. So basically it's, you know, I had CDs available and I did use CD Baby for a while. And there was a time where you had to press 500 CDs to get a price break, you know, or even the 1,000. And I did that on a couple different records. And of course, you have all sorts of CDs left. I still have CDs from those times. Now you can press CDs one at a time, even, you know, so. But back then, you had to get a bunch of them. And I did sell them at gigs quite a bit, or I'd sell them like at local stores that I happened to be around. Never sold that many of them. And of course, now with streaming, it's very low royalty rates.
I don't know if it's me or old age or what it is, but I find myself gravitating in my personal listening to about 3,500 songs, and I have a library of 60,000 songs that I have in my hard drive, but I'm only listening to about 3,500, and it's a lot of Louis, Ella, and so on and so forth. What are your thoughts on the kind of splintering of music going off in a million different directions? And what do you think of smooth jazz, rap, hip-hop, some of these other styles? What do you think about music today?
Boy, how do I say this?
I know. It's hard. You start sounding like an old fogey, you know?
You start sounding like an old guy, but I think I've always kind of sounded like an old guy. To be clear, there are things going on now that are really great. There are some very inventive musicians that are taking the music a lot of different places. But the bad thing about anyone being able to put their music up on Amazon or Spotify or something is that the market is being flooded with music that I don't think is very good. And it's not a matter of genre. It's bad in every genre. I personally don't like music that's lyrically so overt that to me it's...
What do you mean lyrically overt?
Well, I don't like obscenities, every other word in music.
Okay.
To me, it just turns me off. And I think now there are a lot of ways you could say this that I'm not saying it's never appropriate, but with some of the music now, and you know, it's done for reaction. It's not done because it's musically valid.
Everything goes.
Yeah, and I hope music will, I hope things will level out, and I can always find good music to listen to. And I'm like you, where I do sometimes go back to things that I've listened to for years. If I discover something, that's a cool thing. There's sometimes where, you know, you'll be listening to something and something's recommended and you listen to it and you think, oh, wow, I didn't know about that. That's really cool. And that kind of exploration, you know, like YouTube rabbit holes, can be really fun. There are some people making very good music, you know, live to YouTube. Emmett Cohen, that's live at Emmett's place that he started during the pandemic, is just some of the best jazz musicians in New York just come to his apartment, and it's like a big jam session. And he's done over 100 of those, and I'm still listening to those, and they're all musically excellent. And some of them are people I know, musicians I know. Some of them I didn't know but thought, wow, they're just as good as anyone I've ever heard. So there's no lack of good musicians, but everything is getting flooded with people that really shouldn't be putting their music up.
What do you think of smooth jazz? Is there enough depth there for you, or is it kind of surface level?
I think that it's misnamed. There's very little improvisation, and I consider that to be a big part of jazz. I would call it instrumental pop music or something like that. It doesn't hold much interest for me because of the lack of exploration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good definition there, good explanation. It's a lot of hip-hop beats over, yeah.
Yeah, and if I could see that, I can see the potential there. It's really kind of tamed down.
It's kind of where jazz went a little bit, you know. There's still the big bands playing around in Chicago area, mm-hmm. and here in Peoria and other places, but not as much. And if you hear some of the, you know, you get some of the jazz combos still and brunches and things like that, but it seems like jazz is... The jazz I grew up on, the Basie band, the Tonight Show band, and it's kind of waning in popularity today.
Well, it's funny that it is, but it's still there. The Basie band still plays, and they still sound great. And I heard a big band record the other day that is the best big band record I've heard in 30 years.
Oh, tell me.
And it was the Vanguard Jazz Orchestra that started out as the Thad Jones and Mel Lewis band. And of course, they've had that Monday night gig at the Vanguard for 50 years. And it's their latest album, which is all Thad Jones material. It's called Centennial, the music of Thad Jones. Recorded live at the Blue Note. You know, so no overdubs, no special stuff, just set up some mics. It seems very minimally mic'd, but that club sounds great. Every record I've ever heard from the Blue Note, from the Vanguard sounds great. And the playing is, of course, New York's best players. And it is terrific. It is as good as anything that's ever existed as far as big bands. So it's out there.
Yeah, it's just it's a shame. But in ways, I used to tell my kids I'm glad it wasn't popular as much because I got to go see Louis Belson and sit 15 feet from him.
Right.
And I could watch Louis play the drums and see everything he's doing and go up and talk with him on the breaks. And it was amazing going to Joe Siegel's Jazz Showcase in Chicago and being able to see all these great jazz people and talk with them and visit with them. And it was just, I couldn't do that if it was, a Taylor Swift concert.
Right. Yeah, that is very appealing. And I felt the same way. The nice thing about musicians on that level is that they're almost always cool and want to talk with you, and you can ask them, especially if you have a question that indicates, you're wanting to know something.
Right, you got
and
knowledge.
They'll take their time with you. I've had so many people that have taken just a bunch of time. They've taken their whole break just to talk about stuff, and that's one of the best things, and that's how I learned a lot of it.
I know Ray had a huge number of albums and recordings. Is there something that stands out if somebody wants to explore Ray Charles and say, oh, you got to get this one, and this one? What are like your top three Ray Charles recordings that people should explore?
There's one he made with basically a combination of his band and the Basie band put together called, oh man, what's the name of the record?
Is that a yellow cover?
No.
Or a gold cover?
It's called,
yeah, it's okay, we can look that up.
Let's look that up, yeah. And it's a great one. The record he made with Betty Carter, and it's all arrangements by Marty Paish, that is one of my favorites. Just a lot of the early soul stuff he did, really, I think that really hangs together very well too.
Very good. Is there anything you'd like to add or talk about or discuss that we haven't covered?
Boy, we've covered a lot. I'm glad people are still making music, and they always will, because music is important to how people cope with the world, you know. And I'm so glad to have been able to be a part of that, you know, in some little way.
Well, thank you very much for talking with us today. And this is David Hoffman from Peoria, Illinois. Thank you very much, and check out his CDs and stuff online. Bye-bye now.